Good morning. Welcome to King of Kings for our Easter celebration. Christ is risen. He's risen indeed. Hallelujah. Satan's power over us is lifted. The bonds of death have been broken. Heaven belongs to each and every one of us. And today we get to lift our voices in praise together with all Christians on earth and saints in heaven as we join in the first hymn, hymn number 447. Christ is risen. He's risen indeed. Hallelujah, for our Lord God Almighty reigns.
Let us rejoice.
The song of salvation has begun, and it will never end. When Christ emerged from his grave, peace with God emerged with him. Though our hearts are still filled full of shameful thoughts, our mouths are full of hurtful words, and our lives are full of selfish action, There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. With his blood, he has purchased for God persons from every tribe and language and people and nation. The song of salvation has begun, and it will never end. When Christ emerged from his grave, victory emerged with him. Though the world remains full of evil and appears to be in Satan's grip, Christ is seated on his throne. He is King of kings and Lord of lords. He rules over all things with and for his people. The song of salvation has begun, and it will never end. When Christ emerged from his grave, life emerged with him. Though death continues to roar in rage, its sting is lost and its power is broken. Those who die in Christ will live eternally with him. There the Lamb will be their shepherd, and he will lead them to springs of living water. Hallelujah, for the Lord our God Almighty reigns.
Let us rejoice and be glad.
The song of salvation has begun, and it will never end. Today, we who remain here below sing with those who already dwell above. We sing until that day when faith gives way to sight, when Jesus makes everything new and wipes every tear from our eyes. Hallelujah, for the Lord our God Almighty reigns.
Let us rejoice and be glad. Hallelujah.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, by the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, you conquered death and opened the gate to eternal life. Grant that we who have been raised with him through baptism may walk in newness of life and ever rejoice in the hope of sharing his glory. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be dominion and praise now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated. The first lesson for today is recorded in the Old Testament book of Jonah, chapter 2, verses 2 through 9. Like Jonah, Jesus was condemned to death, and yet he emerged to life. Unlike Jonah, Jesus was punished for our sins, not his. He said to the following, "In my distress I cried to the Lord, and he answered me. From the belly of the grave I cried out, and you heard my voice. You threw me into the depths, into the heart of the seas. The current swept around me. All your breakers and your waves swept over me. I said, I have been driven away from your sight. Nevertheless, I will once again look toward your holy temple. Waters engulfed me so that I was near death. The deep surrounded me. Seaweed was wrapped around my head. To the roots of the mountains I sank down. The earth locked me behind its bars forever. But you brought my life up from the pit, O Lord, my God. When my life was ebbing away, I remembered the Lord. My prayer came to you, to your holy temple. Those who cling to worthless idols forsake the mercy that is theirs. But I, with a shout of thanksgiving, will indeed sacrifice to you. What I have vowed, I will certainly pay in full. Salvation belongs to the Lord." The word of the Lord. Our psalm for this morning is Psalm 118. It's on page 6 of your worship folder.
Gives us the victory through Jesus Christ our Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. Give thanks to God, give thanks to God. The Lord is my strength and my song. He has become my salvation. The Lord's right hand is lifted high. The Lord's right hand has done mighty things. I will not die but live, and will proclaim what the Lord has done. Alleluia, alleluia, give thanks to God. He gives us the victory through Jesus Christ our Lord. Alleluia, alleluia, give thanks to God, give thanks to God. I will give you thanks for you answered me. You have become my salvation. The stone the builders rejected has become the capstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Alleluia, alleluia. Give thanks to God. He gives us the victory through Jesus Christ our Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. Give thanks to God. Give thanks to God.
The second lesson is recorded in Paul's first epistle to the Corinthians, chapter 15, verses 1 through 11. Christ is risen, and because of that, we know he is the Son of God. Christ rose from the dead, and therefore we know that the Father accepted the Son's sacrifice. Christ has risen from the dead, and that means that one day we will rise too. Brothers, I am going to call attention to the gospel that I preached to you. You received it, and you took your stand on it. You are also being saved by that gospel that was expressed in the words I preached to you. If you keep your hold on it, unless you believe in vain, for I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. After that, he appeared to over 500 brothers at the same time, most of whom are still alive, but some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, and then to all the apostles. Last of all, he appeared to me, the stillborn child, so to speak. For I am the least of the apostles, and I am not worthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted God's church. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me was not ineffective. On the contrary, I worked more than all of them, and yet it wasn't my doing. But it was the grace of God which was with me that I did it. So whether it is I or they, that is what we preach, and that is what you believe. The word of the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. Christ is risen. He's risen indeed. I am alive forever and ever, and I hold the keys to death and Hades. Alleluia. Please stand for the gospel. The Holy Gospel and also our sermon text is recorded in the Gospel of John, chapter 20, verses 1 through 23. Just as Jesus revealed himself to Peter and the Marys and John, so also he reveals himself to us by faith, so that we might be filled with the peace of the resurrection, and so that we might be empowered to live according to his mission. Mary stood outside facing the tomb weeping. As she wept, she bent over, looking into the tomb. She saw two angels in white clothes sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and one at the feet. They asked her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She told them, "Because they have taken away my Lord, and I don't know where they have laid him." After she said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, though she did not know it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Who are you looking for?" Supposing he was the gardener, she replied, "Sir, if you have carried him off, tell me where you've laid him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and replied in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus told her, "Do not continue to cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father. But go to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." She also told them the things he said to her. This is the gospel of the Lord. Join me in confessing your Christian faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed found on page 9 of your worship folder. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. We'll join in the hymn of the day. It's hymn 441, "I Know That My Redeemer Lives." In the name of Christ, our risen, our victorious Savior, dear fellow redeemed brothers and sisters in Christ. It happened again. Another school shooting. This time was different, though. Different because it happened at a school filled with Christians, but that's not the difference that I'm talking about. Different because in Nashville, Tennessee, only 6 died. Compare that to 21 that died in Uvalde, Texas last year, but any death is just unacceptable. That's not the difference I'm talking about. The difference this time is that there were cameras all throughout the entire building. The police were able to go in right away, and there was someone actually sitting at a computer screen, able to identify exactly where the shooter was, able to guide the police right to their location so they could take that shooter out before there was any more life that was lost. Man, traumatizing. Traumatizing to be outside the building with no idea what's going on, but can you imagine watching it all unfold real time before your very eyes, knowing exactly where the shooter is? Seeing nothing but potential victims in the crosshair, hoping that the police get there in time before someone else loses their life. That's the kind of trauma that you wonder how a person ever bounces back from. Well, I imagine that's exactly the kind of trauma that Jesus' followers and his disciples were feeling after watching the horror of Good Friday. And I'm betting they were still there 2 days later on Easter Sunday morning. Maybe that's why John stressed that Jesus' mother, his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene were standing near the cross. Because they loved their Lord, they were with him to the very end. Because they loved their Lord, they were the first ones to the tomb on Easter Sunday morning to pay their last respects and to prepare his body for burial with the spices that they had gathered. As they made their way to the tomb, they wondered, how in the world are we going to get that stone rolled away from the tomb? And I'm betting that they were probably wondering, too, how they were going to get past the guards that Pilate had placed by the tomb so that no one would break the seal. But it turned out they didn't have to worry about that stone. Mary Magdalene got there first, and she saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb, so she left and ran to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved. They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, she told them, and we don't know where they put him. Her mind must have been racing. And she ran back to the disciples to tell them what happened. And Peter and John were shocked too. We know that because they ran all the way back to the tomb themselves. John got there first. Maybe he was younger. Maybe he was just faster. But he hesitated. He didn't go in. Peter, the impetuous one, he blew right past the entrance of that tomb, right inside, and he saw everything just as Mary had reported it. The body was gone, the grave was empty, and then they left. You find that strange? They didn't investigate any further. They didn't call in other witnesses. They just went back and did what they were doing. Jesus' promise to rise from the dead wasn't even on their minds. I think that's maybe what John's note in the text is all about when he says they still did not yet understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Their doubt, their anxiety, and their fear got in the way of what should have been obvious. Peter and John left, but Mary stayed. Mary stood outside facing the tomb weeping. As she wept, she bent over looking into the tomb. She saw two angels in white clothes sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and one at the feet. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" Again, that's a weird question to me. Why are you crying? She was crying because her heart was crushed. She was crying because she was in shock, so much so that she didn't even notice two angels sitting right in front of her face. She was stuck at the nightmare of Good Friday. The nightmare of seeing the Lord whom she loved hanging on a cross with every bit of life drained from him. The nightmare of seeing his lifeless body laid into the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea that he cut out of the rock. Those were the images seared in her mind. Those were the images haunting her heart. As far as she knew, Jesus was still dead, along with all of his promises of life and forgiveness and of heaven. Her reaction makes perfect sense, don't you think, for someone who's experienced that kind of trauma. But Jesus knew exactly what she needed. Mary turned around and saw Jesus standing there, though she did not know it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Who are you looking for?" "Supposing he was the gardener," she replied, "Sir, if you carried him off, tell me where you laid him and I will get him." Now, commentators have written all kinds of pages trying to figure out why Mary couldn't recognize the voice of her teacher, the one who had just recently told her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me will live even though he dies, and whoever lives and believes in me will never perish." How could she not recognize her voice? Well, some said maybe it was because the tears were blurring her vision. Maybe it was because Almighty God kept her from realizing it was Jesus. Maybe because his body was glorified, confusing even the disciples later that evening. Maybe that's why she didn't recognize Jesus. But I think the best explanation for that in my mind is that she couldn't get past the trauma of Good Friday. She was still stuck at the cross, and when that happens, it's really difficult to see the risen Lord. But you know that. You know that when someone you love, a child, a parent, or spouse, is taken home to heaven, and it seems like it was way too early, you know that sometimes it's hard to get past that suffering and see the risen Savior. You know that when you're trying to figure out how to pay the bills and it just doesn't work out. You know that when your retirement account seems to be vanishing into thin air. You know that when you worry about where you're going to get your medications from because there's some problem with the supply chain. How are you going to get those vital drugs? You know that when you think about the economy completely blowing apart and you wonder how we're going to continue this ministry, how are we going to continue as a church? All those things, they stand in our way, they blur our vision, they keep us from seeing the risen Savior. But the biggest one for me is my own sin. My own sin that put Jesus on that cross, my own sin that put Jesus in that grave. And it would be bad enough if sin were a thing of the past and I didn't have to deal with it anymore, but I keep on tripping up on that same old temptation. I keep falling into that same old sin. How can I get past the cross? How can I move beyond Golgotha? I'm stuck at the tomb because my sin put him there. There's only one way. There's only one way to overcome those sins that sometimes are sins of weakness, sometimes sins are downright choices of mine. The only way to move past those is to see the risen Savior. Easter's the only thing that can do that. Easter's the only thing that can take away the stone, that huge stone of anxiety and worry and fear and doubt. Jesus knew exactly what Mary needed on Easter morning, and Jesus knows what we need this Easter morning too. We need to see Jesus, who went into the grave dead, but came out of it alive. For Mary, all it took was one word spoken from the lips of Jesus. Why was that word so powerful? Because it came from the risen Savior himself. It came from the one who went to the cross to pay for sins in full with his blood. It came from the one who gave us his righteousness as a free gift so that we could appear holy before God. It came from the one who slammed the prison door of hell closed. It came from the one who defeated the hand of Satan and destroyed death forever. It came from the one who rose from the dead and was about to ascend into heaven to receive a position of power and authority so that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. The risen Savior speaks one word. The risen Lord speaks one word, and all the darkness of worry and anxiety disappears in a moment and is replaced with the Son of Righteousness, the Son of Easter. I bet Mary wanted to grab onto Jesus and not let him go. But Jesus had other people to see, other places to go, other names to call out, like Thomas, for example. He had other people to see, like the 500 people that he appeared to at one time. And it wasn't just for those people. It wasn't just for Mary and for John, or for Thomas. It wasn't just for the hundreds. It was for us, so that we would have their eyewitness account. He appeared to Peter so that Peter could assure us we were not following cunningly devised fables when we made known to you the powerful appearance of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. He appeared to John so that as an old man he could write this: that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have observed with our and our hands have touched regarding the word of life, the life appeared, and we have seen it. We testify and proclaim to you the eternal life which was with the Father and has appeared to us. We are proclaiming what we have seen and heard also to you, so that you may have fellowship with us. You wonder how the families of those six people killed in Nashville are ever going to recover. You wonder how the person watching all of that go down on a video screen, how are they ever going to get those images out of their mind? The same way that you and I deal with every bit of suffering in life, the same way that you and I deal with every bit of our sin that put Jesus on the cross and put him in the grave. The very same risen Savior moves us past Golgotha, moves us past the tomb to see that he is risen. Death is dead, sin has been washed away, guilt is gone forever. The devil is done. Heaven is yours. And together then with all Christians on earth and all saints in heaven, we can join in their song of praise and say, Christ is risen. He's risen indeed. Hallelujah. Amen. The peace of God that transcends all our human understanding, guard and keep your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. We respond by singing hymn 451. Thank you. We'll bring our thank offering to the Lord. Please, during the offering, as it's being gathered, or before you leave today, make sure you sign the friendship register. There's a copy of it found in each pew. It's a little red folder. And then make sure to pass it down to everyone else in the row so they have an opportunity to sign it as well. Please stand for prayer. Risen Lord, we want to thank you for this opportunity to gather around your word and to rejoice in the fact that you have kept your promise to offer yourself as our substitute and Savior. Our sins are forgiven by your death. We have the sure and certain hope that we too will rise because of your resurrection. Keep that truth before us for the whole Easter season and every day of our lives, and remind us to use that as strength so that we're not afraid of our enemies and refuse to give in to the temptation of despair in times of trouble. Give us the courage to boldly tell others about your death and resurrection, and do the same for pastors and teachers who proclaim the gospel publicly on our behalf. Our lives here on this earth are constantly changing, but your word and promises are eternal. Help us to use the things of this world to glorify you and to serve your purpose. In your mercy, grant health to the sick. Give us patience in this difficult time, and continually assure us that all things are in your hands. Use your gospel to inspire us to live in the hope of the resurrection, and cause us to look forward to the union with all the saints and angels on the last day, when we will walk behind you in pure and clean robes as you carry out the last and final act of judgment on your enemies before we follow you home to heaven to celebrate with you for eternity. We pray this with confidence because you kept your word, and we rejoice in this Easter peace through you, our risen and eternal Lord, who together with the Father and the Holy Spirit our one God, now and always. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. We'll join in hymn 438. Now may our glorious Father, who by his power raised our Lord Jesus Christ from the dead, give you the spirit of wisdom to know the hope to which he has called you. And may he preserve you in body and soul until your own resurrection on the day of Christ Jesus. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
We'll close our service with Across the Lands. It's hymn 549.
Yeah.
Good morning. Welcome to all of you once again. Welcome especially our guests and visitors that we have with us today. Please make sure that you sign our friendship register so that we can acknowledge that you were here. We'd also like to say good morning and happy Easter to all of our online worshipers. Some of you may not know we have people from all across the country and even other parts of the world that worship with us on Sunday morning. Happy Easter to all of you. Couple of announcements that need amending. There will be weathering the storm this week. Did we decide to go with Wednesday? Wednesday at 6:30, we will have weathering the storm. Also, in your worship folder, you see I'm going to be out of town for a couple weeks, and I provided you with Pastor Enderle's phone number. I don't know how this happened, but somehow I got part of his phone number and part of his wife's phone number. So if you call that number, you're probably going to get a hold of someone in New York who's a total stranger. So make sure you call the office, call Stephanie, and she will get you arranged to see Pastor. Anyone else have announcements they'd like to share today? This is what it's all about. This is what the entire church year is about. Without today, there would be no reason to rejoice ever. But Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again, and we will go home with him.